In this screencast, we are going to go through solving the material balances on a single unit, and we're going to touch on the concept of using degrees of freedom analysis to help us solve our problem, and why it would be important when we start getting into more complex processes. Now, material balances in general are extremely important to perform when designing any kind of process. You can think of this distillation tower and all of the different streams coming in and out of it, and how there are more than likely multiple components, since distillation tower is used to separate those components from each other. So let's take a look at our theoretical distillation column, in which we have three components. We have A, B, and C all entering the column. Here we have A and B in the bottom, and on the top we have B and C. Now this column performs some kind of process to separate these components, as you can see on the streams leaving, likely purifying A into the top stream and then having some components of A, B, and C in the other two streams. So our job as an engineer is to perform the material balances so we could solve for the unknown flow rates of our streams, as well as the compositions that we may not know. For instance, here we have an unknown flow rate M1, M3, and N5. And we call them those because we could say that the streams are 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. And that's just typical nomenclature as we go around solving our problem. We also have unknown compositions, whereas here we're told that 3 weight percent of the stream is component B. We don't know the weight percent here, and we've designated it as X2. So the remaining must be 1 minus x2, since we're talking about a mass fraction. We also don't know the composition in stream 4 for C, but we are given the composition for A. When we solve material balances, or any kind of problem similar to this, we use what's known as a degree of freedom analysis. And basically that breaks down to the idea that we take all of our unknowns and we quantify how many we have and subtract out relationships and equations that we could use to help solve for those unknowns. And if we have enough pieces of information that could help us solve for those unknowns, we should have a degree of freedom equal to zero, meaning that there aren't any more pieces of information that we have to get or specify to solve. It's kind of like in mathematics, if you have two unknowns, you need two equations. Same concept is shown here. So we start with our unknowns. So we don't know the flow rate M1, nor do we know the mass composition X2. We don't know the flow rate M3, or the mass composition X4, and lastly we don't know the flow rate M5. Now we could say we don't know the composition of A here or B in stream 4, however we do have a relationship because we know that the mass fractions must equal 1, so we've just accounted for that and not declared them as unknowns. You could do the other way where you set those as a variable and then relate them to each other, and then you have two pieces of information that you could use to solve for those two unknowns. So when we do material balances, we know that we can balance mass. Mass in has to equal mass out. So we could do this for each component, A, B, and C, and therefore have three balances, one on A, one on B, and one on C. We could also do an overall balance. All the mass entering the system has to be the mass exiting. Now the one thing is that these aren't independent of each other. The overall balance is summing up all of A, B, and C. So even though we have four potential balances, we really can only do three balances to help us solve. So when we want to determine the degrees of freedom, we take the number of unknowns and subtract out the number of balances. And so this means we have 5 unknowns minus 3 potential balances, so we have a degree of freedom of 2. So we have to specify 2 more things about this system in order to be able to solve for these unknowns. So let's provide 2 more pieces of information that's going to allow you to solve this problem. First, the flow rate in M3 is half the flow rate of the feed stream M1. The second one, 90% of all of the C that enters in M1 exits in M5. So now this is 2 more pieces of information that we could use to solve. We could write mathematical equations for these statements that help us solve our unknowns. So when we go back to our degree of freedom analysis, we're also going to subtract out the number of relationships or pieces of information that we could use. Now this is 5 minus 3 minus 2, which gives us 0. And 0 is the magic number that we know this problem is solvable. So first thing we do is write our balances, and I like to personally start with an overall balance. Usually that's easiest. So we know that the mass flow rate in stream 1 plus 5300 has to equal the mass flow rate in M3 plus 1200 plus this unknown M5. So now we can do a balance on A, B, or C. B at least shows up in most of the stream. Let's start with a B balance. And it's important here that we use the mass fractions along with the overall stream mass to account for the total amount of B in each stream. So for instance, in this first stream, M1, let's say we have 1 kilogram of M1. 3% of that is B. So we write that as 0.03 M1 as the total amount of B that is entering in that stream. So we could do the same thing for stream 2, but in this case we're using X2 as our unknown, but multiplying it by a known mass flow rate. So that will account for the B in the second stream. This has to equal no B in stream 3. We have 0.3 minus X4, that's times 1200, plus 0.60 times M5. And that should account for all of our B entering and exiting this process. So at this point, we could do one more balance, either the A or the C. I'm going to choose the C balance. And in doing so, you should get the following material balance for C. So if we just looked at our unknowns in our equations, we have 5 unknowns in 3 equations. So obviously, we couldn't solve with this information alone, but we do have this information up here. So we need to write those down. In doing so, we see we have a relationship between M1 and M3 and M1 and M5. So now we have 5 equations, 5 unknowns, and we start figuring out where to solve. So we need to pick 3 equations that have 3 common unknowns. And we can see that from the overall balance, we have M1, M3, and M5. So if we take the 2 pieces of information that we just wrote up here, they also have M1, M3, and M5. So we have 3 equations and 3 unknowns that we could use. So using equation 3, let's write the other 2 unknowns, let's say in this case M3 and M5, in terms of M1 so we could solve for M1. So I've inserted equation 1 for M3 and equation 2 for M5 to get the following equation. So I have all of my M1 terms on the left side and the rest of it on the right side. So I could solve for M1. And hopefully you get the same answer I did of 2,437 kilograms per hour of M1. I then plug it into my M1 values into equations 1 and 2. And I've solved for the mass flow rates that previously were unknown. At this point, you can see it's just plug and chug. We could use M1 and M5 down here and solve for our unknown X4. Once we have X4, we could put that in here along with our M5 and M1 values and solve for X2. So let's go ahead and put those results. So I've solved for X4, and remember that in our problem statement was for the C component, so it's kilogram C per kilogram of the stream. So then again, we could use that in equation 4 to solve for our last unknown x2. Solve x2 as 0.61 kilograms of B per kilogram, and again, that was for the second stream. So now we have our complete picture of our column. We could place these values back into our schematic to have our final solution. So this should be the final solution to this column with all the proper compositions and stream flow rates. And you can see how important it was to do a degree of freedom analysis at the beginning of this problem, because right away we could find out that at least with the information given, you wouldn't be able to solve it. So we had to provide 2 more pieces of information in order to do so.